Hi friends, and welcome all of you to the yet another video of Theory of Structures 1 lecture series. Before going into the new topic, we will discuss some of the topics we have discussed so far. So in the previous video, we have seen what is mechanics. So mechanics basically deals with the forces and the classification of the mechanics. Mechanics can be classified into rigid body mechanics, deformable body mechanics and the mechanics of fluid, and again mechanics of rigid bodies can be classified into statics and dynamics. Dynamics can be again classified into kinetics and kinematics. We have seen what is a force. Force is nothing but the action of one body on the other. The action can be a push or a pull, and the force constitute three major parameters like a point of application, direction and magnitude. Three parameters are necessary for completely defining a force. We have also seen a couple. What is a couple? Couple is nothing but two equal and opposite forces separated by distance. Also seen what are the basic units, and some basic definitions are discussed like scalars, vectors, parallelogram law of forces and Lamy's theorem. Lamy's theorem states that if the three forces acting at a point are in equilibrium, then each force will be proportional to sine of the angle between the other two forces. And we have also discussed the resolution of forces. Resolution is nothing but resolving a resultant into its component in x and y direction. So we have seen the component of the resultant in x direction, the theta is making an angle with the horizontal, it is r cos theta, and y direction is r sine theta. While considering the resolution of a number of coplanar forces, we have a number of forces like r1, r2, r3. So each forces can be resolved into two components in x and y direction. One is in horizontal direction and one is in vertical direction. After resolving each force into its component, we will find the net force in x direction and the net force in y direction. Final resultant can be obtained equal to square root of sigma h square plus sigma v square. Now coming to the today's topic. So we are first discussing about the moment of a force. Before discussing the moment of force, we will see a picture. It is a body and it is acted by a force. A path of the force is majorly known as the line of action of a force, and we are considering a point O. So about that point O, we are considering the moment of a force. So we have a force and we have a point. The distance, the perpendicular distance from the point O to the force is r. The moment of force defined as the product of force and the perpendicular distance of the line of action of a force from a point is known as the moment of a force. What is the tendency of this moment? So know that the force is acting like this, and the moment will be about this point O. So this moment will have a tendency to rotate this body in clockwise direction. So we are considering the point and the force is acting like this. So it have a rotation in the clockwise direction. So if the force has a opposite direction, then we will have a moment in the anti-clockwise or counterclockwise direction. So that is about the moment of a force. So next topic is the principle of moments, or it is also known as the Verignon's principle. So in order to discuss that, we will see a picture. Here two forces are shown. F1, F2 are the two forces, and R is the resultant of these two forces. The resultant of F1 and F2 is R, and we are considering again a point O. This is our point of consideration. So from this point O, the perpendicular distance to R is, perpendicular distance to the resultant is small r, and perpendicular distance from O to the first force F1 is R1, and the second force is R2. So if it is clear, then the principle of moment states the moment of the resultant, that is the force into the perpendicular distance, will be the moment. So the moment of the resultant will be equal to the algebraic sum of the moment of the all the forces acting on the system. So we know that these are the two forces mainly acting on this, and R will be the resultant. So if we consider the moment of the resultant about the O, that will be equal to the sum of the moments of the forces F1 and F2. In a statement, we can conclude that it states that the moment of the resultant of a number of forces about any point is equal to the algebraic sum of the moments of all the forces of the system about the same point. The clockwise moment as positive and the anti-clockwise moment as negative. So here about this point, every force have a clockwise moment. If every moment is clockwise, then we can have a plus sign. So the moment of the resultant is equal to the moment of individual forces. So F1 into R1 plus F2 into R2. This is principle of moments. The figure shows the application of Verignon's theorem. Here one force is shown. The force 100 Newton is acting along the line ACB. This line is called a line of action of the 100 Newton, and this is our point of consideration, that is the point O. So we know that this distance, the distance is shown as 3 meters. So if you consider the moment of this force, this magnitude 100 Newton into the perpendicular distance, we have to multiply. Since we didn't know the perpendicular distance between the point and the force, we are applying the principle of moments here. We can see the same force is acting at here, and we are resolved the 100 Newton into two components. This angle is 60, so 100 into cos 60 will be the horizontal component, and 100 sin 60 will be the vertical component. So when we apply the principle of moments, we know that the resultant, the moment of the resultant will be equal to the moment of the individual forces or the components. So if we want to find the moment of the resultant or 100 Newton, then it is equal to the algebraic sum of moments of its component. So we have one component that is going through the point O, and one is perpendicular to the point O. So the component which is going through the point O will not have any perpendicular distance, and the other force, that is 100 sin 60, will have a perpendicular distance of 3 meters. So resolved into two components, and taking the individual algebraic sum of moments of its components. So the final value of moment of 100 Newton about the point O will be 100 sin 60 into this perpendicular distance, 3 meters. Our next topic of interest is the system of forces. So basically, the system of forces can be mainly classified into coplanar forces and non-coplanar forces. You may be heard of this from coplanar. Coplanar means the forces occupying in the same, if the forces are not in the same plane, then it is called non-coplanar forces. So in a coplanar forces itself, concurrent force system, you may be heard that if the forces are assumed to be concentrated at a single point, then it is called a concurrent force system. If it is not concentrating to a single point, then it is non-concurrent. So non-concurrent itself, we can classify into parallel and the general concept. If the forces acting are parallel, then it is called a parallel force system, and if it is not, then it is called a general concept. Similarly, the non-coplanar forces can be again classified into, non-coplanar is again the 3D. So it can be again classified into concurrent and non-concurrent, and again it in the parallel and general. So we will discuss it in detail. So this is the coplanar system of forces. So different coplanar system of forces. One is the basic one, that is called the collinear system of forces. We know the term collinear means acting in a line. So the forces acting in a single line is called a collinear system of forces. It is also occupying in the same plane. So example is the tug of war. And the second one is called a concurrent at a point. So you can see that here all the forces are acting in an XY plane. So we have a number of forces F1, F2, F3 and F4. So which are assumed to be act at a point. So this force system can be assumed to be a concurrent at the point O. Coplanar concurrent forces. So next is parallel. So we have a number of forces and which are acting in a XY plane, and the forces are separated by equal distances. So this is called a parallel system of forces. If all the forces are acting in the same direction, we can call it as like parallel forces, and if the forces are in the opposite direction, then unlike parallel forces. So this is the general concept. So you can get the example from here. So this is the coplanar concurrent forces, and this is the example of a parallel force system. So here is nothing but a seesaw. Children are sitting at the two sides of the seesaw. Weight of the two students are acting downwards. Okay, so this is example of a like parallel forces. And another concept is the general force system. In a general type of coplanar forces, it doesn't have any common pattern, like no such forces are assumed to be concentrated at a single point, or no such forces are parallel. So in a general fashion, all the forces are acting in a simple plane. Similarly, we have a non-coplanar system. The specialization of non-coplanar system means the forces are not acting in a same plane. So instead of a 2D, it is 3D object. First one is a concurrent at a point. Here we discuss all about a body in the XYZ direction. So a body in which a number of forces are acting, like F1, F2, F3, F4, F5, a number of forces are acting at the different planes of the body. So each forces are assumed to be concentrated at the point O. It can be called a non-coplanar concurrent system. It is an example. It is a cone. It's a solid cone, and in which a force is acting at here, and also we can consider a force is acting here and a force acting here also. So all the forces are assumed to be concentrated at the point O, but each forces are acting at different planes. So this can be assumed as a non-coplanar concurrent force system. So other one is similar to the 2D system. We have a body in the 3D. So it is acted upon by a number of forces, and each forces are assumed to be in a different plane, but the forces are parallel or equidistant from each other. So this system is called a non-coplanar parallel system of forces. Example is a typical table with a weight. The weight is acting vertically downwards. Since the table is resting on the ground will offer a reaction to the weight through the legs. So this system is example of non-coplanar parallel force system. And the general concept similar to the other, it doesn't have any common fashion. So all the forces are acting in a random manner. So here we can see a number of actual cases to the system of forces. So first one is concurrent coplanar forces. So here it shown is a roof truss. We can see in the industrial building and of this. Here a number of forces. Here the forces will be acting along the member, and it is assumed to be concentrated at a point, and also it is lying in the same plane. So it is an example of concurrent coplanar forces. And the collinear forces we have already seen. It is a tug of. So it is a picture of a hanging grid, and it is having a number of vertical members as shown here. So since the members are parallel, the force produced in the member, that is an axial tensile force that is produced in the member, will also be parallel. And these members are occupied in a single vertical plane. And this is an example of a non-concurrent coplanar forces. So non-concurrent meaning this force are not assumed to be concentrating at a point, and this all forces are assumed to be in a single plane. So it is a coplanar system of forces, totally a non-concurrent coplanar system of forces. And this is an example of concurrent non-coplanar system of force, meaning the forces are assumed to be concentrating at a point, but the forces are acting at different planes. Next we have a concept called free body diagrams. So free body diagram can explain with this figure. So we have a box unloaded from a truck through a pulley rope systems. So two persons are pulling the rope and unloading this box. So this system, the entire system can be represented in a simple schematic diagram as shown here. So if the weight of the box is known to us, then we can mark it as 736 Newton. So and the tension in the ropes TAC and TAB can be represented simultaneously and acting 30 degree and 50 degree to the horizontal. So in a typical free body diagram, a sketch showing the physical condition is represented as a sketch showing only the forces on the selected particle. So this is called a free body diagram, and this is another example of a free body diagram in which a metal sphere is hanging from a point A through a string, and the weight of the body is acting downwards, and it is resting on the wall at a point C. In order to draw the free body diagram of this body, we can represent the body along with the forces and the reactions coming to the body. So we have the body, and the weight is acting downwards, and this is a reaction of the wall to the body, and the string have a tension that is represented as F. This is called a free body diagram of this setup. Next we are going to discuss a concept which is the basic building block of theory of structures, which is called the equilibrium. So before discussing what is an equilibrium, we will consider a 3D body. This is a three-dimensional body which is having an X dimension, Y dimension and a Z dimension. So this body is acted by a number of forces like F1, F2, F3. A number of forces are acting on the body. If it's so, a body subjected to a number of forces is said to be in equilibrium. The first condition states that the sum of all the external forces acting on the body is equal to zero. We know that the body is acted by a number of forces. If the body is in equilibrium, then the sum of all the forces will be equal to zero. That is the first statement. Then second statement states that the sum of all the moments of external forces about a point is equal to zero. So we know that about a particular point in an object or outside the object, we can take the moment of all these forces. So if the body is in equilibrium, then the sum of the moments due to the external forces will be zero. So these two conditions are shown mathematically here. First condition states that sum of all the external forces acting on the body is zero. So we have a number of forces. What we do is we will resolve this component into x, and we resolve every force into x and y component. And x, since the body is 3D, we have to consider the z direction also. So we will take the condition as sigma fx equal to zero. That is, algebraic sum of the force in the x direction will be zero, and the algebraic sum of the force in the y direction is equal to zero, and algebraic sum of the forces in the z direction will be equal to zero. That is the first condition, the sum of all the external forces acting on the body equal to zero. So second condition state that sum of the moments of external forces about a point is equal to zero. So if the point is taken somewhere here, then sum of all the moments about a x-axis equal to zero, sum of the moments about a y-axis equal to zero, and similarly sum of the moments about a z-axis equal to zero. Even though it is seems to be a simple concept, we can solve a number of civil engineering problems based upon this equilibrium concept. So these are the mathematical formulation for a 3D body. When we come to a 2D body, that will be the most of our concern. So this will be the equilibrium conditions for a concurrent force system. And for a general non-concurrent force system, we will have the independent equation as: first one, it is the algebraic sum of force in the x direction is equal to zero, that is sigma fx equal to zero, and algebraic sum of the force in the y direction, that is sigma y is equal to zero, and the third one, it is algebraic sum of moments about the z axis. Z axis will be the axis that is perpendicular to both x and y axis, that is facing towards you. So that axis, the moment about that axis will be zero. That are the reduced consideration of the independent equilibrium equations. So basically in our 2D problem, we will apply these three conditions. The conditions are applied to solve the complicated problems. So before going into the problem directly, we will see some more concept, the types of support and the reaction forces. You may be heard the term beam, right? Beam is a structural component which mainly carries the vertical force coming on the system. Okay, so here one such beam is considered. So here we are explaining the different types of support. So first one, it is called a roller support. As an example, you can consider the TV stand, your older TV stand. It may be provided with some rollers. So similarly, we can consider a roller. So in this typical roller type of support, the beam can be move in horizontal direction easily, but it cannot move in upward direction. The only possible movement of this roller supported beam is in the x direction. So it is free to move in x direction, but it is restrained in the y direction. So there will be a reaction acting in the upward direction. So this is the free body diagram of the support. At the roller support, the only restraint provided is shown as the reaction. So that will be the vertical force F, that is about the roller support. So next type of support is called a pinned support or hinged support. Difference from the roller support is that the beam is pinned, or it is a bolted as shown here. So here it is bolted at similar to a hinge, like your door. It is hinged at this point, and the hinge is again bolted here. If you see the movement of this support, it cannot move in horizontal direction because it is bolted. It cannot move in vertical direction. The only possible movement is it can rotate. When the vertical load comes here, it can rotate. When we see the free body diagram of this support, you can see that it cannot move in vertical direction. So there is a restraint Fy, and it cannot move in horizontal direction. There will be a restraint called FX. So this is the free body diagram of the support. As in the case of roller, it can move in X direction, so there is no restraint in X direction, but only have Y direction restraint. But in the case of pinned or hinged support, there is restrained in both X and Y direction. We have one more support called a fixed support. So example of a fixed support is the sunshade of your house. The sunshade, it is a fixed type of support. In the case of fixed support, part of the beam will be enter inside into the wall. So that is called a fixed type of support. In the case of fixed type of support, we can see that it cannot move in vertical direction, it cannot move in horizontal direction. And also, since some part of the beam is enter into the wall, at the support point it cannot rotate, but it can deflect at this point. If the load is coming, the beam can deflect, but it cannot rotate at this point. So the rotation also here is restrained. So if you see the free body diagram, it cannot move in Y direction, so there is a vertical restraint. It cannot move in X direction, there is an X restraint, and also there is a restraint for the rotation as moment. So these are the three possible type of supports for a beam. This show the graphical representation of how we represent a support and the free body diagram. So this is a simply roller support. Rollers are shown by like this fashion. This is the representation of a roller support. This is a roller beam. So beam supported at both end by rollers. Then the free body diagram will be shown like this. That is, there is a reaction in the A and the reaction in the point B. So next we comes to the pinned supported beam. We have both end A and B are pinned supports. So pinned support is shown by like this. And if you come to the free body diagram, we know that since the pinned support have a restraint in X and Y direction, X direction have restraint and also Y direction have a restraint. So at the point A, X direction restraint is shown by RAX and Y direction restraint is shown by RAY. Similarly at the point B also. So their resultant is shown by RA and RB. Since the third one, the fixed support, the both end are fixed in the case restrained in horizontal direction, horizontal movement, vertical movement and the rotation. So this is the free body diagram of the fixed support, which have a restrained in vertical direction, a restrained in horizontal direction and a restrained in rotation from at the both ends. Based upon the various support condition we have discussed in the previous session, we can classify the beams accordingly. So first we have a cantilever beam. So cantilever beam is one which having one end free and the other fixed support. This is called a cantilever beam. So second one, it is called a simply supported beam. Simply supported beam is one, the both end are just simply supported. This is called a simply supported beam. Next is called a overhanging beam. Overhanging beam is nothing, just a simply supported beam with the one end it is having some overhanging portion is there addition to the simply supported beam. That is called a overhanging beam. Next is called a fixed beams. Fixed beam is nothing but the both end of the beams are fixed support. So both end are restrained in horizontal, vertical and rotational movement. That is called a fixed beam. Last one is called a continuous beams. Continuous beam is one which is having more than two supports. If it is having only two supports, it is called a simply supported beam. If more than two supports are coming to a simply supported beam, then that is called a continuous beam. Next, we will consider some of the different types of loads coming on the beams. So here we can see that here is a beam is there. It is a simply supported beam. So it is subjected to first kind of load, that is a concentrated load. Concentrated load or the point load, it is nothing but a load which is assumed to be concentrated at a point. The second type of load is called a uniformly distributed load. We can explain simply by above the beam, if we construct a wall of uniform height. If the wall of uniform height is constructed over the beam, then the weight of wall to the beam will be in a uniformly distributed fashion. So it will have a constant magnitude and it will be uniformly distributed along the length of the beam. That is called a uniformly distributed load. The third one, it is called a uniformly increasing load or uniformly varying load. So we can see that here a trapezoidal type of or linearly varying type of wall is constructed over the beam. So the fashion of that load transferring to the beam will be in a trapezoidal fashion or uniformly increasing or uniformly varying load. These are the three possible type of loads acting on. With the concept discussed so far, we will now go to a problem, a simple problem, that is determine the reaction at the A and B. So here we have a beam, so which is hinged at the one end and the roller supported at the other end. So it is basically a simply supported beam. So this kind of beam is called a simply supported beam, and the beam is subjected to a load of 40 newton at L by 4 from the support B. We need to find the reaction. So with our knowledge about the free body diagram, we know that the hinged support will have the two restraints, that is horizontal and vertical restraints. So it will be developed at this hinged end, and the roller will have a restraint in vertical direction. There will be a vertical reaction set up at the B. So RAY is the vertical reaction at A, and RAX is the horizontal reaction at A, and RBY is the vertical reaction at B. Problem can be solved by applying the conditions of equilibrium for the forces. So we know that for the 2D case, the three equations of equilibrium are sigma Fx equal to 0, that means algebraic sum of force in the horizontal direction equal to 0, sigma Fy equal to 0, that means algebraic sum of force in vertical direction is equal to 0, and sigma Ma equal to 0, that means algebraic sum of the moment equal to 0. So we will apply each condition separately. So first condition is called algebraic sum of force in horizontal direction equal to 0. So we know in this system horizontal reaction acting at this point, but we don't have any other forces in the system. Consider this condition. The only force which is acting in the horizontal direction is RAX. So RAX equal to 0, since no other forces are there, reaction is reduced to 0. So next we consider sigma Fy equal to 0, that is algebraic sum of force in vertical direction. So we have two vertical reactions developed at A and B respectively. Vertical reaction at A is RAY, and the vertical reaction at B is RBY. And we have one more force, 40 newton, acting in the downward direction. So if we consider the algebraic sum of force in vertical direction, if we consider the upward direction force as positive, the downward force will be negative. RAY plus RBY minus 40 equal to 0. So these two forces are in positive direction, and this force will be in negative direction. So RAY plus RBY minus 40 equal to 0. This will be our second condition. So next condition is sigma M equal to 0. So this is algebraic sum of moment about any point we can take. Moment about A is taken. So if the moment is taken, so we have a force RBY is acting at a distance L from this point A, and 40 newton force is acting at a distance 3 by 4 L from A. So if we consider algebraic sum of moment, we can take either one moment is in positive direction and the other in the negative direction. So we will first consider, so RBY into L, this is the moment of this force about the point A, and next one, it is 40 into 3 by 4 L, which is the moment of this force about A, so which is equal to 0. That is our third condition. So while solving this condition, we can get RBY value. RBY by solving, we get 30 newton, and substituting this value in the second equation, we can get RAY is equal to 10, and we first condition itself, we know that RAX equal to 0. This is our solution to the above problem.